Hello, everybody, and welcome to Cooperative Learning 101. My name is Elena. I teach third grade in room 13.
And I'm Michelle. I teach fourth grade in room 17. I moved. No, give me a break.
Anyway, we are doing this just as a little preparation to, first of all, advertise a new phenomenon that's coming to Harvest Ridge. Every Thursday, we are totally copying off of Tech Tuesday, and we're making Teamwork Thursdays. Every Thursday from 8:15 to 8:30 in the Learning Commons, you can join a group of us who will be presenting one cooperative learning structure a week that you can take right back into your classroom and use immediately. And since our school improvement plan has cooperative learning as our plus one instructional strategy that we're going to be implementing and monitoring this year, it'll be a great way just to review things you may have learned in the past or get some new ideas for use with your students.
And you may be wondering about,
That's all right.
Oh, sorry, this is Elena. My name is Elena.
That was my slide, Michelle. Anyway, the first thing that we wanted to share is a quiet signal, one tenet of cooperative learning, because the kids so often are simultaneously engaged with each other. They're all going to be talking all at once much of the day as they work in their learning teams. It's important as a teacher you get to get their attention very quickly. You can see some statistics on the screen about how much instructional time could be lost just trying to get kids' attention if you're not effective and efficient about it. So two things to keep in mind. You can use anything you want, but you want to have a sound paired with a movement, and that makes a quiet signal. There is a lot of research that says that when the students actually move, it increases oxygen to the brain and really just gets them engaged and keep them awake throughout the day. So just one example, maybe last year we had the PD from Sharon Faber, and she loved the maraca, which you could use, but after you shake your maraca, perhaps the students know that they shake a pretend maraca in the air and their eyes need to be on you within 2 seconds. And wouldn't it be cool, Michelle?
You know, I think, this is what I'm thinking.
What?
And you might be thinking the same thing.
Maybe.
I think it would be really cool if everybody, Harvest Ridge, would have the same quiet signal.
That would be awesome. We need to brainstorm that. So, if you guys come up with a
cool
quiet signal, we need to start chatting, and maybe that's something we can roll out by next year. Awesome.
Okay, so, and you may be wondering what is cooperative learning? Well, two structures, class building structures, team building structures. Class building, just like it says, whole class participates. They move, they stand up, they walk around, everybody works with everybody. The whole class is working together. It's fun, and research shows that a class runs better and less discipline problems, less organizational problems, if you do a class builder structure at least once a week. And you can also do it, you can implement these within content as you need it, whenever you see fit with whatever content area you're studying. It's a good brain break. It creates safety, builds community with the class, and it gives the kids a little something different to do.
And the second level of that would be team building. We're going to talk in a minute about how to create teams within your own class, but the team building is the smaller little maybe pods or groups or teams that you have within your class that work together on day-to-day activities. The team building, because you certainly would not want to throw, say, the quadratic equation at a bunch of fifth graders and say, here, work together on this. Cold turkey. It probably would not go well. You'd experience frustration, discipline, you'd have kids refusing to work, or you'd have the bossy kids doing all the work. So one way to avoid that is to be proactive, and before you give these kids any content work to do with their team, you first want to do some team building. So these are really, really great things to do to kind of front load at the beginning of the year, and then just throw in, they can be as little as 5 minutes long each and require little to no prep time a week or, once or twice a week throughout the year, or when you refresh your teams and regroup students to do some of those again to get them acclimated to the new students that they'll be expected to do content work with.
Okay, so what about content? How could you use this with your curriculum? You do have cooperative learning resource books provided with units of study, and we're having our Team Thursdays, little mini PD sessions to help you figure out, okay, this sounds really good, but how do I use it with body systems or, different units that you're studying, or how do I use this with math? There's also other resources. And August 21st, that's our first little Teen Thursday PD, which we will be going over the structure quiz trade, which I think that structure you can use with almost anything. We've used it with spelling, math, science, social studies. Also, lots of resources on Google, Pinterest. Look for McRell, Kagan, Johnson & Johnson. They're the ones that are the pioneers of our cooperative learning structures.
And something to keep in mind, because there are obviously infinite resources that may have the label cooperative learning on the internet, but not everything that has kids working together, just because it's group work doesn't mean that it is true cooperative learning. I know that we learned the McRell tenets about cooperative learning, how to implement that with QFIC. Some other things to keep in mind as you implement formal structures. PIES is kind of a pretty good acronym just to be a starting place to keep in mind. You want to make sure that the kids have positive interdependence. Is my game your game? You don't want that the job can be done without all kids participating. And if one kid learns something, all of them learn something, and it's reciprocal the entire time. Then you have equal participation. You don't want one kid to be a team leader, you know, we all have those kids, and then have three just be the little underlings that follow directions. You want all of them to feel like they have equal status. Individual accountability also means that the kids feel on the hook, and if you've done an effective job of building those teams, they're going to not want to let each other down. You know, they're going to have that drive to live up to the expectations of their classmates and make sure that they do their part to create a quality work. And finally, there's simultaneous interaction. This is like the opposite, I guess, of direct instruction. It's not one person talking and everybody else listening. A majority of the class is going to be talking all at one time. And this is a really great place, our voice level chart that we have, just to make sure, you know, there should be like a buzz, an active buzz about your classroom whenever cooperative learning is going on. Because lots of kids are going to be talking all at once. And therefore, if they're talking, they are engaged.
Okay, so forming teams would be a very important thing to start with in your classroom as you start the year and before we get into the actual specific strategies and structures. Forming your team, and I want to first say that I know that we don't always have the best case scenario for a four-person team, but it's best to have a student team of four or less. It's a little more difficult to have like that person, that fifth person tacked onto the end when you're talking about shoulder partners, face partners, and that whole team simultaneous interaction. So four or less, this is a good plan to group your kids. Go through your whole class list, look at reading level, look at, you might want to wait, you know, a couple weeks into the year and rate your kids either high average, low average. Those two would be kind of your middle of the range kids, and low. And you'll probably, this is very general, doesn't need an assessment. It's your subjectivity, just so when they're participating in these team structures, you have that equal participation opportunity. And that low person does gain, but the low average person does gain, the high person does gain, high average. And if you do have those leftover pods of three or maybe even two, try to keep those kiddos the middle of the range, not a high and a low together, obviously. But that's the best case scenario in the real world. I know that our class list might look a little different, but just a little guideline here.
All right, and here are just a few items. Dawn Day from third grade very graciously shared some things that she had used in her classroom. The top left, you're going to see a little team mat that she has in the middle of every group of students. And you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4, those are those high average, low students. And for example, the 1 would be the high student, and the 3 would be the low student. And because they either talk to the kid next to them or across from them, you'll never have the high talking to the low, because they would just most likely frustrate each other. And so the kids knowing just kind of where they stand in the team, it makes it very easy having these numbers assigned that you can just say, talk to your face partner, talk to your shoulder partner, or work with them and so on. It's a really useful thing that we are definitely going to share with you. Something to look forward to are coaching gambits and praising gambits, which are often very silly and make the kids giggle. But it's just another way to keep this whole thing positive and help them to learn how to encourage each other. And finally, little color posters, which will be your attendance prize. If ever you decide to join us on a Team Thursday, upon leaving, you'll get a cute little cheat sheet with this year's very trendy theme, the chevron, to hang up in your classroom, because often we know it's hard. You go to PD, then you kind of forget because it gets piled under something on your desk. Not that that happens to me ever. But having these posters up just would be a quick reminder, because like we said, most structures take little to no prep time. You're not going to sit down and make 1,000 index cards or anything. They're just very easy to implement, and having that little poster, we hope, will help to keep it in the forefront of your mind as you tackle your year's curriculum.
Okay, that is our cooperative learning things to know before you start our PD sessions and things to get you started for the year. So if you have any questions, you can email myself. I'm Michelle Kelly.
And I am Elena Liscom.
We will give you your prize package full of some resources to get you started for the beginning of the year, and hope to see you at our Team Thursday.
Woohoo! Thank you. Have a great year.